Chaksun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimati Bhakti Vedanta Swami Iti Namine. Namaste Saraswati Devi Gondavani Pacharine Nirvishesa Sunyavadi Astyatya De Satarine. Panchakalpa Rubhischa Kripasindhu Bhavacha Nitanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namaho Namaha. Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Srivasati Gaur Bhaktivindam. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So again, spiritual sound vibration, Sabda Brahman. When we chant Hare Krishna, we are meant to be in contact with Lord Krishna and associates. So someone asked Srila Prabhupada, what is the purpose of chanting Hare Krishna? Of course, Prabhupada answered these questions differently according to the questionnaire and the situation where the question was asked. And here, we get to the essence. The idea is to connect with Krishna or to be in contact with Krishna. In this world, we get in contact with each other through sound. So sound vibration in the spiritual realm connects us spiritually. Goes on to say, this is the nature of spiritual vibration, which is different from the kind of sound vibration that is only heard. When you write Hare Krishna on a piece of paper, it is as whole and complete as when you speak it. This is called sabda. Sabda is not limited to something that is communicable only from mouth to ear. The spiritual energy or potency manifests itself in sound, and this is called sabda. And because it is spiritual, it does not have the restrictions that material communications have, or which this world has. So what's being said here is that even if you write it on paper, it is also has sound vibration, because anything spiritual is not limited to material definitions. In other words, it transcends the principles. So writing it or speaking it or hearing it, it's all sabda or spiritual sound vibration. Generally, when we speak of sound, we mean material sound, a transformation of information that is heard with the ear. And certainly that is also the characteristic of spiritual sound vibration, but it's not limited to only that. The difference with spiritual sound is that it's more than merely communicating a message. The sound itself contains within it and is empowered by spiritual potency. And that means it represents the spiritual realm and spiritual energies, either in part or whole. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says, Nam Nam Akari Vahuda Nija Sarvasakshis, that Krishna's holy name has all spiritual potency. So, in other words, the name of Krishna and Krishna is not limited to only Krishna, it means everything in relationship to Krishna also. This is illustrated, or what we say, proved by this statement by Lord Chaitanya. The holy name of Krishna contains all the potencies of Krishna also. That means his names, his forms, his qualities, his pastimes, all contained within the sound of Krishna's name. When we say, how are you? How much potency is in that? When we say Hare Krishna, then everything that exists within the spiritual world is compressed within that sound vibration. Mm-hmm. So Krishna's name is more than just his name. It's the compressed form of everything spiritual. And the presence of that potency is there, whether you see it on paper or whether you hear it. In other words, just like Krishna's form is Krishna, sometimes we see people like to draw a picture of Krishna. Sometimes they do that outside and put it on train, on the walls of train terminals, or somewhere on outside. That form that's been drawn indicating Krishna is also Krishna, because his form is non-different than himself. His name is non-different than himself. His qualities are exactly the same as him, along with his pastimes. So whether you see it, hear it, write it, speak it, it's all contains within it all the energies of the Lord. Srila Prabhupada uses the same word we use. He also says, how are you? But because he is speaking from the spiritual platform, his words are saturated with spiritual potency. Therefore, his words have more impact. It is no longer just a question. And even further, aside from posing the questions, the word, being from the spiritual plane, also purifies the heart of one who hears them and frees one from material contamination. So not only do you hear it, but it also has a purifying potency to it. It is not merely inquiry about well-being. We're using the word, how are you again? The intent is coming from the spiritual world to liberate us, to bring us closer to Krishna, and that in itself comes across. It is a complex and detailed matter. So when the spiritual master says, how are you? It's not just some greeting. It is actually bringing you closer to Krishna. In the Vedanta Sutras, it is said that sabda actually liberates. Sabda means spiritual sound. So when we say Hare Krishna, these are names, but within these names, because all the potency of God is there, it is like being in the presence of the Lord, like reading all the Vedas, like seeing the spiritual world, like hearing all of Krishna's pastimes, like understanding all the philosophy, if you know how to connect with sound. So if you know how to connect with spiritual sound, you're actually connecting to everything that is within the realm of spirit. Spirit, again, is not limited like material sound vibration. So the challenge is how to connect with the spiritual sound. Now, because with any kind of relationship, so we're trying to have a relationship with Krishna, there must be more than just transmission. There has to be reception. If we are transmitting, but the other person is not receiving, then it's not working. It's like if I'm talking now and someone is not listening, maybe they got their computer on and they're doing something else. So they're not listening. So there's no receptivity, the message is not working. It is the same with all our modern media communications. All of it is based on information coming from one side and received on the other. So if the receiver is faulty, the whole thing fails. Like when someone sends us a kirtan online, if we do not have the right program on our computer, then the file appears as a bunch of squiggles. That's all. It's the same if we are not tuned into the sound vibration. So there has to be receptivity of the sound. So not only chanting, but hearing. Sometimes when we are preaching to people, they say, "Show me God." So this is how you can see God, by saying Hare Krishna. But you have to hear it in a certain way. Because if your consciousness that is perceiving, it is your consciousness that is perceiving, not your ear. Just like if someone's talking to you and you're not listening, there's no benefit, there's no communication. So the parts of the body function only when the consciousness is connected in relationship to the information receiving senses, such as the ear, the eye, and the tongue. It's like you can be seeing something, but if you're thinking about something else, you might be looking at something, but you're thinking something else. You're not actually seeing what your eyes are focused on, because your mind is somewhere else. So more examples, just like my tongue is speaking and that sound is going through the microphone. But the microphone is not hearing anything because it's not conscious. It's only transmitting the sound. It doesn't hear. Same with my ear, it's an instrument. I'm hearing, the soul is hearing, but if the soul is contaminated, it cannot pick up the message of Hare Krishna, then it is interfering. So the challenge in our Krishna consciousness movement is to be proper recipients. Our ears are the general instruments, but those are not enough because it's just not a sound vibration. That's simply a terminology. Sabda works on the level of consciousness. In other words, sound vibration only is picked up on the level of consciousness, not only through the receptivity of the ear. So it may be coming in through the ear, but if the consciousness is not connected, the connection is not there. We have to have the proper consciousness in order to connect to the sound vibration. So here we go. The purification of consciousness needs to happen so that there is no obstruction. When we hear Hare Krishna without offense or interference, then Srila Prabhupada says we come directly in contact with God. So purification of consciousness is necessary. How is that done? By chanting Hare Krishna. It is the means and it is also the end. To hear Hare Krishna is the means, and the goal is to hear Hare Krishna. Even by faulty chanting and hearing, the consciousness becomes more and more purified. So even if there's some fault, there's some benefit. Then one can actually recognize that there's no difference between Krishna and his name. And what happens? The whole spiritual world unfolds when one says Hare Krishna, because within that, Nija Sarva Shaktis, all the energies of the Lord are present. Then all 18 potencies of Godhead are present within the sound vibration. Nothing is held back. It is a wonderful experience. What are we doing? Is practicing. So we're practicing to chant Hare Krishna, although we're chanting Hare Krishna. Someday we'll be able to chant Hare Krishna. Right now we're in the process of learning how to chant Hare Krishna. We are trying to purify our consciousness in order to perfectly hear and chant the holy name of the Lord. So hearing and chanting purifies the consciousness. And when the consciousness is purified, then we can hear the holy name. See, so the means and the ends are actually the same. That's why when someone asks Srila Prabhupada, what do you get from chanting Hare Krishna? Prabhupada said, we get more chanting, that's all. Once the consciousness is purified, then we can connect to the holy name like that. Then we can chant with pleasure and it becomes a wonderful affair. This is expressed in a very powerful verse by Srila Rupa Goswami. He says, I do not know how much nectar the two syllables Krishna have produced. When the holy name of Krishna is chanted, it appears to dance within the mouth. We then desire many mouths. When the name enters the holes of the ears, we desire many millions of ears. And when the holy name dances in the courtyard of the heart, it conquers the activities of the mind, and therefore all the senses become inert. So that's by Rupa Goswami. So his chanting of ecstasy is that this, I only have one tongue, but that's not enough. I want more tongues so I can chant the holy name. I want more ears so I can hear the holy name. So that's a complete transcendental experience. In our conditioned state, we're getting a little taste. But for one who's in the transcendental consciousness, the taste is millions of times greater. And the nature is the experience is that one wants to have more and more and more. Despite the fact that we are not charged a price for the mantra, or that it's not a secret, or that we can take it anywhere, chant it anywhere, still the divine name of Hare Krishna mantra is never diminished. Understanding these things, we should see what a wonderful thing Hare Krishna actually is. So this is a beautiful explanation of the holy name by Maharaj. And the more we practice chanting, the more we become purified, the more we become purified, the more we can start to chant. And when chanting actually starts to come, then we get a taste, and that taste just inspires us to chant more and more. And one thinks that there's nothing better than this. Okay, so anyone like to comment a little bit on chanting the holy names of the Lord or something in a relationship to what we read today?
Sudhir Maharaj.
Roberto.
Amazing. Thank you very much for this article. Just amazing to go deeper into chanting. And thank you very much for this point that I remember when you had here a session about the mind here in Nita room in the Bhaktivedanta Manor. One thing that really stuck to my mind was that chanting is not actually saying things, it's actually hearing things. It's like actually to hear it. And now you actually went even deeper with actually, it's not about hearing, it's actually hearing with consciousness. So actually this hearing with consciousness is such a powerful statement actually. Being fully conscious, I guess that's why sattva is important, to be fully conscious what you are doing.
And it's the consciousness that actually hears. The ears just pick up the sound, but if the consciousness is not there, then the sound is not received.
So this is like
Bhakti Siddhanta makes that same point. He says, you know, when we see things, are we actually seeing? He says, until the mind actually comes into contact with the process of seeing, the objects that we're looking at are not actually being seen. It's only the consciousness that sees. It's only the consciousness that hears. These instruments that we have in terms of our senses are just simply instruments for reception and for communication. But it's consciousness. So, but as being made in this verse, that until the consciousness becomes purified, we can't really hear the chanting of the holy name, although the sound is going in. So, but the sound can going in, we are actually purifying our consciousness to the stage where we can actually start to hear Krishna's name.
So Maharaj, what is it when we are honoring prasadam? In the same way, we are actually, you know, senses is the tongue,
yeah,
but the consciousness
thing. Yeah,
so how, like, consciousness tries to should they focus on the taste? Should I focus on, you know, it's given by Krishna? What do you suggest?
Well, you should think this taste is Krishna. Mm. Prasadam is also non-different than Krishna. And if you're meditating on Krishna, that this taste is actually Krishna, then you are actually honoring Krishna in the form of prasadam. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, you're just eating food. You'll get something out of it because it's prasadam, because it'll work anyway. But the developed consciousness that manifests through eating prasadam is focused during the whole process of taking prasadam. So that means the mind has to be there too, not just the tongue.
Right. So they said that we, yes, please.
That's why we say we honor prasadam. It's not like eating prasadam, we honor. Honor means to receive a respectable personality.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Very well. Hare Krishna. Okay. Anyone else?
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories, Srila Prabhupada. All glories to you, Maharaj. Thank you so much, Maharaj, for the wonderful lecture on Holy Name. It was really nice listening that up in this week, especially. I wanted to ask, when I came to Ljubljana, there was said that Holy Name is given a form as Holy Name Prabhu or a male form. So how do we visualize that the name has a form, basically? Is it like, are we saying that because name is equal, Krishna's name is equal to Krishna, that's why the name has a form different than Krishna, or same form as Krishna's form?
Krishna's name is Krishna. Krishna appears within his form, or he appears in his name. Therefore, it's still Krishna. Krishna's name is Krishna. Krishna's form is Krishna. Krishna's pastimes are Krishna. Krishna's deity is Krishna. The form of the name is Krishna, because it's Krishna. If you think that there's something different between the name and the form, then you're making a relative distinction, because it's the holy name is not based, it's not something material. Krishna's name is Krishna. When you actually purified and fully chanting in a purified state, you might also see Krishna in the form of his name. In other words, Krishna may appear to you in his transcendental form, because within the name, the form is also there.
Thank you, Maharaj. That's nice.
Within the name, the form is there. Within the form, the name is there.
Yes.
This is absolute. If you think in terms of material, you think in terms of relative. In relationship too, but it's not in relationship, it's absolute.
Yeah, so it's one basically, it's just,
yeah. Krishna's name is Krishna.
Yes.
The scripture says, Nama Chintamani Krishnas Chaitanya Rasa Vigraha Purnya Sudya Nitya Mukta Abhinna Tvam Nami Namino. Abhinna, binna means different. Abhinna means no difference. No difference between the name and the person who is named. It's the same. But we make the relative difference, and therefore we can't understand the transcendental position of the name.
Thank you, Maharaj. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Okay. Anyone else?
Hare Krishna Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. Thank you so much, Maharaj, for your wonderful class on holy name. So I wanted to share something I heard in the recent Chaitanya book compilation class by Solinath Jayapathak Maharaj. So in that, one of the five books of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu he's using for compiling, in one of the books Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is comparing the chanting of the holy name to a yajna, and the tongue is a ladle that pours out the ghee of the holy name into the yajna kunda of ear holes. So I was, it struck me so much that how important that if we don't hear, and then we are letting that ghee fall out and not in the Yajna Kunda. So thank you for telling us again and again in different ways and forms about the importance of the holy name and then how we have to take it very seriously.
Yajna Sankirtanai. The chanting of the holy name is the yajna of this age.
Thank you, Maharaj. Hare
Krishna. Hare Hare. Thank you. Anyone else?
Thank you, Guru Maharaj, for your beautiful talk. So typically within this conversation, we've been talking about the Hare Krishna mantra is having all the potencies. And I'm just wondering if all the different names of Krishna have that same potency. And even within other disciplines like the word Allah and Jesus. So first, first the primary names of Krishna and then the other disciplines.
Yeah, that's mentioned in that verse, Nam Namakari Bahuda Nija Sarvashya Shaktis Tatarpita Niyamitas Marane Nakalaha Tarda Sri Tavakripa Bhagavan Mamapi Todaiva Midrisame Hajari Nanu Raga. So this is the verse that has that term, Nija Sarvashaktis, all the potencies of the Lord. But this, in the interpretation given by the Acharyas, Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that there are primary names and secondary names. So in the primary names, yes, such as Govinda, Gopinath, Gopijana Vallabha, Shamsundar, these contain all the energies of the Lord. The secondary names refer to his qualities, like Brahman or Paramatma, or if you say the word God. In other words, the functional names of the Lord, which refer to his energies that carry out a specific service, they don't have the complete sarva shaktis. They don't have all the potencies of the Lord. So, and the pastimes potencies are not in these secondary names. Where in the primary names, you'll find the qualities and the pastimes are there also. Everything is there. So the distinction is between primary and secondary names. So you just have to know which names are primary, which names are secondary. So those names that refer to his pastimes and his relationships with his devotees are generally his primary names. The functionary names, that just like Ishwara, the supreme controller, that's his functionary name. That doesn't contain all the potencies of the absolute truth.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Hare Krishna. So that's clear?
Yes, that's clear. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and all glories to you. I just would like to thank you for this amazing class, because it again reminded me how much holy name, and especially Japa, is our very, very dearmost friend. Because Japa never lies about what is our real relationship with Krishna. Because as you spoke, I just realized that because actually we don't hear our Japa with, and Kirtana also, with our ears or brain, but because our with our consciousness, these are actually connected. And I just felt that I should really, really cherish more Krishna in this very intimate form, when he really he's always there and never lies, and sometimes even gives his causeless mercy. So it's just, I just don't know why I always forget this, and thank you very much for reminding me again.
Yeah. Just like it is said that once chanting the holy names of the Lord can purify one from all the reactions of all sinful activities that one can possibly commit for millions of lifetimes. So when the consciousness is in the most receptive mood and the sound vibration is pure, then immediately the purification goes all the way. In other words, it is complete. At that point, everything is destroyed, all sinful reactions, all material, everything. But to get to that stage of consciousness, sometimes it happens automatically when we're free from the encumbrances of unnecessary thoughts, and the consciousness is in the most receptive mood. Then when we hear that sound, although it's almost like involuntarily hearing, it's not like we're trying to hear, it just happens because the consciousness is completely open. When that happens, then one gets realization of the power of the holy name and complete purification. So getting our consciousness to that stage of receptivity, is the whole process of Krishna consciousness.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Very well. What blocks that receptivity is our rascal mind.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. All glories to Your Holiness. I was wondering if Your Holiness would be kind enough to throw some light on this outdoor event for World Holy Name Week that we are planning here in New Orleans. If I may ask a question.
I don't know. What's the question?
The question is this, that what will be the receptivity of the people, because we are just announcing this as a public event, everyone is welcome, we're going to be singing and dancing, and there's a free vegan treat for everyone, we're just asking you to help spread peace and healing to the whole planet, that kind of thing. But how many people will really be in the mood to hear the holy name?
Doesn't matter. Fact that they're hearing is benefit. Whenever people come together to hear and chant, it's always, everyone benefits. The chanters benefit, the hearers benefit, the trees around benefit, the insects, they also benefit, everyone benefits.
Okay, thank you so much.
You don't look convinced. Your audio went off. Okay.
No, I'm convinced, definitely. That's why we do public Harinams. I mean, I'm totally convinced that we must somehow or the other spread the holy name, and that's how we are undertaking this this outdoor event. But my concern was during this today's lecture, how important it is to prepare our consciousness to hear the holy name. And I was thinking about the people who are going to come, you know, some of them inebriated, some of them just, you know, all.
It doesn't matter, whatever. You can't do anything to make their consciousness any different. All you can do is give them the holy name. That's why we're providing that, so they can benefit. There's always benefit, no matter who comes. Even if someone chants, there's called namabas, chanting jokingly, chanting in a derisive manner, chanting accidentally, it's always benefit. Doesn't matter.
Okay, thank you so much.
Holy name is, the holy name is pure.
Thank you.
Maharaj, can I get one more question, please?
Okay.
One more question. What does it mean to actually chant purely? As actually, you're speaking at more like we have to concentrate our mind to hear it. So what does it mean to actually chant purely?
The actual chanting purely or chanting with pure intention?
Is there any difference?
Different things.
Okay.
Well, chanting with pure intentions leads to pure chanting. Pure intention of the chanter is to glorify the Lord, is to please the Lord by glorifying the Lord. That's the principle of pure intention. Why am I chanting? Well, I'm chanting to get my rounds done. I'm chanting because my spiritual master said I have to. I'm chanting because, you know, I'm initiated. I'm chanting because it makes me feel good. Well, I'm chanting to please the Lord. I mean, one can chant for different reasons.
So it's motivation. It's like when we start to say the Maha Mantra and then the consciousness to actually kind of receive it.
Okay. Consciousness should be being purified, should be being elevated as you're chanting. You're starting to blot out all the distractions. You're starting to focus simply on the name.
So should we when we are actually, you said to chant only to glorify the Lord, so you shouldn't like, oh please Krishna take me out of this world, or Krishna
well that's not wrong. Yeah, that verse from the Shikshastika, Inandantanuja Kinkaram Patitam Mam Vishame Bhagambudo Kripaya Tavapala Pankaja Stita Duli Sadrisham Vichintaya. O son of Maharaj Nanda Krishna, I am your eternal servant. Somehow or other, I've fallen into this ocean of birth and death. Please pick me up from this death, from this ocean of death, and place me as one of the atoms at your lotus feet. So this verse is actually connected to the mood of the chanting.
Okay, let me try.
Yes. The first of the Shikshastika prayers, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Hey, thank you, Pat. Mm-hmm.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, please accept my humble obeisances. Yes, Madhvi.
Madhvi.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. I've got a question from not what we've talked about today. I appreciate that. It's quite good. But from Srimad Bhagavatam, I've been reading Srimad Bhagavatam this morning. We were reading. It's Canto 4, text 22. Chapter 22, text 30. And generally, like, we are following the four principles, and there are sinful activities. We should be away from that. But in that one, it says that Kshatriyas are allowed to do that.
Much.
Yeah, I'll just read from it. Kings sometimes are killing animals to practice for them for fight with their enemies. But then it's saying four kinds of sinful activities: associating with women for illicit sex, eating meat, intoxication, and gambling are allowed for the Kshatriyas for political reasons. Sometimes they have to take to the sinful activities. Kshatriyas do not refrain from gambling. So that does, I don't understand that, Maharaj. Can you just clarify?
It's clear. What clarification do you need? It's not for devotees. We're talking Kshatriyas. We're not talking about devotees.
No, not devotees, Kshatriyas. But why they have to be allowed to do, like, gambling, yeah, this one, there, and killing for them. But why they have to eat meat as well? Allowed to eat meat and have illicit sex?
It's concessionary.
Oh,
wow. Okay. Yeah, Prabhupada makes that point. Which verse is it you're reading from?
It's Canto 4, chapter 22, verse 13.
Canto 4, what chapter?
22.
Canto 4, chapter 22.
It's
13:1-3. Okay, let me see. Canto 4, chapter 13.
No, chapter 22.
Chapter 22. Oh, okay. Chapter 22 and verse 13. So it says here. See, it says, kings are not only great, but they are also absorbed in sense gratification, but are sometimes employed to kill animals in hunting because they have to practice the art of killing. Otherwise, it's very difficult for them to fight their enemies. Such things are not auspicious. Four kinds of sinful activities are allowed for the Kshatriyas. For political reasons, sometimes they have to take to these sinful activities. Kshatriyas do not refrain from gambling. Okay. Yeah, for Kshatriyas. Now we're talking about devotees. We're not talking about Brahmanas. We're not talking about Vaishyas or anyone else. Specifically for certain politically motivated people. They do it as a service, as a way to increase their service. Why do they have to eat meat?
Yeah.
Well, if they're going hunting to practice how to kill animals, then that animal should not be killed just in vain. It's just for Kshatriyas. We're not Kshatriyas, don't worry. It's not for us.
Thank you much.
Even if you are a Kshatriya by nature, you're a devotee, and that's what you follow, the devotee nature, not the Kshatriya nature.
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Maharaj, for clarifying.
You just take it as it is.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. Please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna.
I can send you those files individually instead of there's about 15 files inside. I can send them in individually, and if you can't open what I sent you.
Yeah, that would be helpful.
Yeah, it'll take a little time, but I'll do that. Yeah. No, it's okay.
Guru Maharaj, I was reflecting a lot on, we do this japa retreat in ISKCON, and one of the key units in every japa retreat is forgiveness. And I was wondering if you could speak about the connection between forgiveness and japa.
Forgiveness and japa. Well, the absolute principle of purification is chanting. One who is chanting develops good qualities. If they're actually chanting properly, the good qualities start to manifest. Forgiveness is one of the prime qualities of a Brahmana and in general for devotees. So, what I can think in relationship to your question is that by perfecting our chanting, we also develop these qualities such as forgiveness, humility, tolerance, patience, pridelessness. It's a way to develop these qualities. Because the holy name will awaken the soul's natural good qualities automatically if we're chanting without offense. And by doing that, the qualities become part of our character. Forgiveness becomes not something you have to, struggle to manifest. It becomes part of your nature. Because all these good qualities are in the soul anyway. They're just covered with this material activities. chanting cuts through that and awakens our pure spiritual nature, which includes all the good qualities that the soul carries. So we might say that, yeah, this is one of the ways to increase the quality of forgiveness is through chanting. Was that the answer you're looking for?
Yeah, thank you, Gurmaj. I was wondering if our relationship with other devotees, it just kind of makes me reflect on if our relationship with devotees increases the quality of our japa or how they're correlated, if at all. But I understood your answer. Thank you so much. It's, I've always wondered.
Okay. Yeah, that's also correct. If we're associating in the proper mood, yeah, then our qualities will also increase. We're forced to manifest these qualities in the association of devotees. After a while, at the beginning we're forced, and then it becomes more natural.
Thank you.
Okay. Hare Krishna Guru Maharaj, can I have a question connected to the previous one?
Okay.
Because you mentioned that as we are chanting, after some time good qualities manifest, and you mentioned tolerance. And I was just thinking that there is this Trinada Pisuni chain of verse which says the other way, that if we are tolerant and humble, then we can chant the holy name. So these two are connected back and forth. So how does it work?
Yeah. By chanting, you become more tolerant, and by practicing tolerance, you can develop the quality of your chanting. It's always like that with any of the qualities. Chanting produces helps to awaken the qualities, and by practicing the qualities, it becomes easier and more natural to chant.
Oh, it's good to know. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Is that clear? Is that clear?
Yes. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Okay, if there's no more questions, we'll stop here. Again, this lecture that I gave today was an article by Shivaram Maharaj. I was just commenting and reading at the same time. So it's from a book called Chant More, which is a recent release by Shivaram Swami, collection of writings about the holy name. If you happen to get a chance to get this book, you'll find some amazing things in relationship to the holy name.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Hare Krishna. Satyanarayan is here. Accept my humble obeisances. All goes to Srila Prabhupada. It's not a question, but I like to share something. As you were mentioned about Shivaram Maharaj, sometimes last year, I went to Soho Street to do my service, and Shivaram Maharaj was sitting on a stair, and quite many devotees surrounding. And he called me, and I went to him. I asked him about his health. He asked me about my health. I paid obeisances. And then he asked me just two questions. One of them is, He said, Satyanarayan, are you chanting extra rounds? And the second question was, are you reading Srila Prabhupada's book?
Books.
So I said, yes, Maharaj, I chant extra round, but not every day. Sometimes when it's possible. He didn't say anything. And regarding reading Prabhupada books, I said, yes, I do read Prabhupada books regularly. Now, my realization is, I took it as Maharaj asked me to question, there is a reason behind it. So I took it as number one is mercy, and number two is instruction. So since that, I started chanting extra rounds every day, not one or two, but I chant minimum 20 rounds instead of 16, as I took as instruction. And I paid more attention to read Prabhupada books as well. So I thought I'd just share my realization.
Hey, that was nice, thank you. Yeah, that's nice. Yeah, we want to, just to follow the process is nice, but when we actually taste the happiness and the sweetness of the process, increase is automatic. It's automatic. Okay, thank you. Okay, we'll have to leave here for, we have to move on to our next service here. But thank you very much, and we'll see you all tomorrow for more.
Thank you, Guru Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Marani.
Thank you very much, Gurudev. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Govardhan Leela.
Hare Krishna, Guru Maharaj. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Valerino Dini, Roberto.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Thank you so much.
Jachi Narayan.
Thank you very much, Guru Maharaj. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the class. Okay, Maharaj, hope it will be better soon.
Huh? Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
I'm
thank
okay.
You.
Nothing wrong with my health. It's just an overdose of computer, that's all.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj. Thank you very much.
Vivekananda
Maharaj, thank you very much.